So what does it say? So x, let A be an open covering. Of what we need is, so the standard hypothesis is a compact metric space, So let A be an open covering of a compact metric space, X. Then there is delta bigger than zero. So this is a Lebesgue number associated. Lebesgue number. Associated to the open covering A, associated, depends on A, to A. So this is the Lebesgue number, associated, such that every subset of X within diameter smaller than delta is contained in one of these, in one A, such that every subset of delta, of X, with a diameter, smaller than, less than delta, is contained in at least one A in A. So the proof. So X compact, so this is a general fact. X compact implies X limit point compact. That's very general. So if we have compact, we have limit point compact. X limit point compact, this we proved. Limit point compact, metric, and metric. So this implies X is sequentially compact. So X is sequentially compact. So we will use only, in the proof, we use only that X is sequentially compact, okay? Which it is from this hypothesis. So we use only the proof. We use only that X is sequentially compact. Okay, so by contradiction, suppose there's no delta. By contradiction, suppose there does not exist such a delta. There is no such delta as in the theorem. That means for each delta, so for each delta bigger than zero, what does it mean? That's not good. So there exists, there is an A, there is a subset, A delta of X, of diameter less than delta, but not contained in any A in A, okay? So no delta is good. Okay? So there's a subset A delta of X of diameter less than delta, but not contained in any A in A, okay? But not contained. No delta is good. In any A in A. So for each delta we have this. And what we consider now is delta equal 1 over n. So let, so choosing, we choose delta equal 1 over n. So we have a 1 over n. So we have, for each delta we have this, so we have a 1 over n. Diameter less than 1 over n, but not contained in any a and a. So we choose a point. Let a n be in a 1 over n. So what is the name of this? Well, it doesn't matter really, but I will follow. Okay, I don't know. So choose, let a n be in a 1 over n. So the sequence a n has a convergent subsequence, okay? The sequence a n. So we have a sequence. So a n obviously is non-empty now, because it's not contained. The sequence a n has a convergent subsequence. Because it's sequentially compact. That's what we use. Subsequence a I n, a n I, sorry, a n I. Okay? And 1 and 2 and 3 and so on. That's a convergent subsequence. So a n I converges to some a 0 in a, no, in x. So it's not good notion, so I call x 0. In x. So it converges. X is sequentially compact. Every sequence has a convergent subsequence. So let, we have an open covering. So we have let a zero, let x zero be in a zero, which is in a. This is an open covering, so we have something. And now, so we have metric space. So this is open. So we get a ball, x0, some radius epsilon. And I take 1 over n immediately, OK? 1 over n. Be contained in a0. Because this is open. A0 is open, x0 is in a0, so we have such a ball. And now we see a picture, and we see there's a contradiction, of course, now. Because, so we have a here, let me make this picture, we have, sorry. We have this sequence, where is it? A and I, here's, so here's a sequence, and this converges to x0, no? So this is converging to x0. So now we have a one over n here. So this is a n1, a n2, and so on. Okay. But recall that this is these are points in a n1. So here's a n1, here's a n2. But recall that the diameter of this a n1 a n I is smaller than 1 over n I, okay, by hypothesis. The diameter is smaller. So finally, we are very close to this point because it converges against this point. And these sets which contain these points here, the diameter gets less and less, smaller and smaller. Then it is clear that if you are very close here, to this, and the diameter is also small, then this will be contained in this, okay? And that's a contradiction, because so this is the usual. So here we see that's a contradiction here, okay? We can write, of course. So let what we with n in n such that 1 over n is smaller, n over n, such that what do we need? That's the distance between a I in n, that's the distance of a n I, and x0 is smaller than 1 over 2n. Okay, so it converges. And 1 over n I, so n I gets bigger and bigger, is smaller than epsilon 1 over 2n. So we can have both, okay? If n is large, if ni is large enough, then we have both. And then we take a point, then a ni, this a ni is contained in the ball x0, 1 over n. And so this is contained in a. What is A? Did I write A? Yes. I don't see. X0 is an A0, no? A0. That's what I called A0. Okay. And this is the usual triangular inequality. If you take a point here at Z, then the distance between Z and x0, smaller equal distance of Z and, so the point to compare is y, ani plus distance ani x0. So this is smaller than. So the distance between Z and ani, where is that? It's also an a and I, okay? So this diameter is smaller than 1 over n, okay? So plus 1 over n. And then the distance between a and I is also 1 over 2n, sorry. What did I write? 2n, yes, 2n. So we have 2 times 1 over 2n, so we have 1 over n. And this means, of course, that Z is contained in BD, x0, 1 over n. OK, so that's a proof. That finishes the proof. So now proof. We have missing in the theorem one direction. That's the direction 3i implies I. So this means x is sequentially compact. Comma hypothesis. That's 3i, and metric, of course. That's a general hypothesis. And this implies x is compact. We have to prove compact now, OK? Sequentially compact implies compact. So x compact. So proof. This is the direction 3i implies I of the theorem. I implies 2i. I wrote here, compact implies sequential, limit point compact. 2i implies 3i was an exercise, which says limit point compact metric implies sequentially compact. And this is sequentially compact implies compact now, OK? So proof. So we have a little lemma. So lemma. For for each epsilon bigger than zero, there is a finite covering of X by balls, open balls of B. No, I didn't write it. By open balls of radius epsilon. For each epsilon, there is a finite covering of X by open balls of radius epsilon. Okay? So proof. First of the lemma, proof. Lemma. Of course, if X, we have to prove X is compact. If X is compact, this is okay. Because we take all epsilon balls, and if X is compact, we have a finite subcovering. So this is true if X is compact, okay? But we have only sequential compact here. So proof lemma. So I make a picture for this. So we take any point, let X1 be in X. So here's X1. Well, by contradiction, I should write that probably. For each, there's a finite. Suppose, by contradiction, sorry, I should write how we want to prove that, by contradiction. Suppose there's no finite. Covering of X. Of balls of radius. Epsilon. So now I restart. So let X1 be in X, any point. Take any point. So we have X1. Now we'll make the picture here. So we have X1. So we have the ball of radius epsilon. So this is a ball around X1 of radius epsilon. This is contained in X, but it's different. Because X is not a finite union, okay? It's 1. It's not a finite union. So this is not. So let, then here, let X2 be in X minus B. X1 epsilon. Okay, so we take a point outside here, X2. Okay? So take the epsilon ball around X2, again epsilon. This is the union of these two, it's not everything, because no finite subcovering, okay? So there's a point X3, which is outside these two, okay? So take the ball. These three do not cover, and so on. Okay, so we find X4 outside this, so X4. So recursively, we construct a sequence, so recursively, inductively, recursively, we construct a sequence so how is it called, Xn? Such that, what is the, such that the distance between, what is the distance between xn and xm if n is different from m? So we have always bigger equal to epsilon, okay? Because we go out of the, so it's small, bigger equal to epsilon for all n, m, and of course, different from m, okay? The next is always epsilon distance from all before. But that means xn has no convergent subsequence. Okay, because in a convergent subsequence, the distance gets arbitrarily small. Okay. So this implies Xn has no convergent subsequence. Contradiction. So that's the proof of the lemma. And now I will write here to finish the proof of this. So how to do that? We choose the usual open covering A of X. Okay. So proof. And now I have 3i implies I again, no? So first the lemma, okay, and now the proof. So let A be an open covering of X. We have to find a finite subcovering, okay? We want to prove X is compact. So we have to find a finite subcovering. Let delta be a Lebesgue number associated to A. To this open covering. Now that's a Lebesgue. We have sequentially compact. So we prove for sequentially. No problem. Then A will be associated to A. So then consider there is a finite by the lemma. Sorry. By this lemma. By the lemma. This lemma, which we prove, by the lemma, there's a finite covering of X. There is a finite covering of X with balls of radius what do you suppose? Delta over 3 of radius epsilon equal delta, maybe over 3, okay? So we have of radius epsilon delta, so of diameter smaller than delta, okay? Of radius and diameter, so of diameter what is it? 2 delta over 3, no? Which is smaller than delta, of diameter smaller than delta. So by the lemma, there's a finite cover of X. Each of these balls is contained. It's contained in some A in A, OK? So each of these balls a finite covering with balls of radius. Each of these balls is so this implies each of these balls is contained in some A in A. Now that's what delta says, okay? Each of these balls is contained in some A in A, but we have finitely many only. So finitely many balls cover X, okay? So finitely many elements in A cover X, okay? Finitely many balls first, but now, so this implies finitely many. A in A cover, sorry. Finitely many A in A, so it gets, I'll finish here, A in A cover X. So X is compact. That's a proof. Okay. Now, what we of course, we have the point that compact implies limit point compact. For metric spaces, they are equivalent. I'll continue here now. But for arbitrary spaces, they are not equivalent. So we want to prove that. And this is the last example, important example for us in, of the book. There are many more, but they depend all on these, more or less. So I will continue here now. So this is a long exercise. Okay, this is, so we, I want to give a space which is limit point compact, but not compact, okay? So S omega and its properties. So this is S omega. If we want, if we don't want a Hausdorff space, okay, then they are very artificial examples, but not interesting, okay? If we want a Hausdorff space, this is a Hausdorff space, okay? This is not artificial. So you, in the book, you have some exercise or some example where there is an example like this, but a non-Hausdorff space, which is very artificial, okay, if you look at the construction. Not, not too interesting, but it exists. If you want Hausdorff, it gets more difficult, okay? And this is not artificial. This is very natural in some sense. If you like logic and this kind type of mathematics close to logic, then it's a very natural space. So you know what means the well-ordered. An ordered set, an ordered set, what ordered? Order for us is linearly ordered, okay? Complete order, completely. Or linearly or whatever. A completely ordered set is well ordered. X is well ordered. So that you probably know. If every every non-empty subset has a smallest element, okay? If every non-empty subset, non-empty of course is important, non-empty subset of X, every non-empty subset of X has a minimum. Has the smallest element, which is the same. That's well ordered. So example, typical examples are the typical examples are the natural numbers, okay? That's well ordered. But Z no, okay? Yes. Z no. Q. Take also the positive. So we here we go to n minus infinity. Now, well ordered means that it has the smallest element, okay? So maybe you have the smallest element zero here, but still it's not well ordered, okay? So whatever, if you talk about rationals, it's not well ordered, okay? Maybe it has the smallest element. So this would be bigger equals zero, no? That is not well ordered. The reals are not well ordered, okay? Well, it has no smallest element, but take the positive and zero, okay? Then it has the smallest element zero, okay? But it's not well ordered. No. So the only, the prototype seems to be the natural numbers and subsets of the natural numbers, okay? Finite subsets, of course. So there's a, we will use, there's a famous theorem. This is a well-ordering theorem. That is associated to the name of Zermelo. What does it say? It says every set X can be well ordered. Every set X, set X, can be well ordered. Which means there is an order on X, which is a well ordering. Okay? For example, the standard ordering of the reals is not well ordered. But we can, there is a, the theorem says there is a, we can well order the reals. So the proof, I will, there is, so probably somebody of you know, this is equivalent to what? Thorne's lemma. Thorne's lemma, equivalent to, but for, before Thorne's lemma, there's something more, in, even maybe more interesting. If you're given to what? Thorne's lemma is okay.
The axiom of choice.
Yes, equivalent to the axiom of choice. Which is more basic maybe than Thorne's lemma, no? But they are all equivalent. Equivalent to the axiom of choice and Thorne's lemma. So if you assume the axiom of choice, the proof is not so difficult then, okay? However, I will comment in the book. So what we need is the following. We want the following theorem. So you know what we want. Theorem. There is an uncountable well-ordered set. Uncountable, well-ordered set. This will be S omega. We call it S omega, okay, afterwards. This is our S omega. There's an uncountable, well-ordered set such that each section of S omega, such that, let me call it X for the moment. A well-ordered set X such that every section. What is section? Sx of x. So x is an x. So what is this? Sx are all points y in x which are smaller than x. Everything which is smaller, that's a section of x. That's just a name. Every section sx of x, so this is are all y in x which are smaller than x. So if you want, this is in the minus infinity x, no? But it's well ordered, so it has the smallest element, okay? So this is also alpha 0 x. Now close here. So this is, well, this is the smallest element which exists, okay? Smallest element. Of x. Every well-ordered set has the smallest element. So there is an uncountable well-ordered set X such that every section Sx of X, and this is the decision, is countable, okay, is countable. Okay. So in a sense, how to think of this, I will make a picture also. So S omega, X, so this X here, is the minimal uncountable well-ordered set, the smallest uncountable well-ordered set, okay? But so X is the smallest. It's not so clear what that means, no, maybe, but you can think about that. X is the smallest uncountable well-ordered set. So that's the way to think about it. It's a minimal, the smallest, the minimal. Whatever, these are words only, okay? So that's a good way to think about this. So let's see the proof of this. So, proof. That's our S omega. okay, this X will be always, it's unique also. This is, there's also uniqueness. So what? So I want to comment on this. In the first chapter of the book, he gives a proof which does not use the well-ordering theory, okay? So it does not use axiom of choice, well-ordering theory, so on, so on, whatever. It does not use it, okay? So one can prove this without. But then, if you want to prove anything about this without axiom of choice, you cannot prove anything. You don't prove anything, okay? So it's not useful then. If you don't assume the axiom of choice, it exists, yes, but you cannot prove anything, almost nothing, okay? You need, then you need the axiom of choice for the properties, okay? So then we use the axiom of choice immediately, and we use the theorem, okay? The well orders. So let Y be an uncountable well-ordered set. And here, so I use the theorem. Exists by the well-ordering theorem, okay? We use it. Exists by the well-ordering theorem. So why? Then, if every section of Y is countable, then we have already the set. Okay, if every section of Y is countable, take for X equal to Y. Then we are done already, okay? We have an uncountable well-ordered set. Each, every section is countable. That's what we want. Otherwise, if otherwise, the set of all points Y and Y, subject the section of Y is uncountable. So if every section is countable, we are done. Otherwise, this is non-empty, okay? There are points where it's uncountable. So it's not empty. But Y is well ordered. So this set, so too many names here. It's not empty, so this has the smallest element, okay? So this set has the smallest element. Y zero, whatever. Then the section of this Y zero is uncountable. That's the smallest element of the uncountable, okay? Then S Y zero is uncountable. But for if Y smaller than Y zero, it's countable because it's smallest, okay? But for every Y smaller than Y zero, S Y is countable. So every section of S Y zero is countable. every section of SY0 is countable. Then take x equal to this SY0, which is uncountable, but every section is countable. So we are done. So that's the end of the proof. There's also uniqueness, but so let's see how does such a well-ordered set look like. No, so I make always this picture, which is sort of, so this is well-ordered. Okay, it's not the reals. The reals are not well-ordered. So well-ordered. So the order is smaller than this. Smaller. Okay. So this is, suppose this is well-ordered set. So if it's well ordered, it has the smallest element, right? Alpha zero. A well ordered set has the smallest element. Then, in a well ordered infinite, otherwise maybe it has only one element. That's not interesting. Okay. So then we take all elements which are bigger than alpha zero, and this has a minimum again. Okay. So there's alpha one. Call it alpha 1, okay? The next one. There's always the next one now. So there's alpha 2. There's always the next one, okay? Alpha 3. And so on. Suppose that's uncountable. So we never, okay? So we get always the next one. So what we see the natural numbers, okay? Well, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the order, okay? It's in bijection with the natural numbers. But this might be all, okay? But if it's uncountable, it's not all, right? So we have all these elements, and then we have all elements which are larger than all these, and this has a minimum again, okay? How do you want to call that? This is the first limit point, okay, of our set. The first limit point. So this is called omega. Okay, omega, you recall from R omega, okay? This stands for countable. So this is the smallest element. And this is the first limit point. Okay, because here we have accumulation. These are discrete, okay? It's an order topology. We take the order topology, okay, on this set. But here it's not discrete. This is the first limit point. Of the set. Of the whole set, okay? This is the first limit point. But then it goes on as before. Next one. How do you want to call this? Omega plus omega, no? 2 omega. Well, it's just the name. That's the next limit point. It's discrete. Here it's not discrete, no? So next limit point. The point is every element has an immediate successor, okay? The next one. You take everything which is larger and the minimum. That's the next one. But not the predecessor. This, yes, but this, no. Over here, I have accumulation. So now, what is the next one? 3 omega. So now we have 4 omega. So now, it's all countable still, okay? So we suppose we can go on and go on, okay? Never finish this. So what is here's the next step. What is this? In this, what? Yeah. So how do you call this? Omega square, yes, omega square, okay? So this is the first limit point, which is the limit that's the first limit point of limit points, okay? Here, the limit points accumulate, right? So first limit point of limit points, of these, no? This is the first limit point of limit points. But it's always countable, okay? Let's suppose we can go on and go on. So it's countable. So we start always from the beginning, right? We start always from the next one, and so on. So we restart, in some sense, from here. We go like this, okay? It repeats. And then you go on, and at a certain point, you have omega 3, okay? And then we have omega 4. But it's still countable. There's no constructive proof of this set, okay? There's no constructive proof. I suppose if there would be a constructive proof of the existence, then that would be a proof of the well-ordering theorem of a special case, maybe, but of the axiom of choice, of some version of the axiom of choice, okay? Sorry?
Constructive mathematics doesn't
mean. Yes. So now I lost, what I wanted to say? And you go on. At a certain point, you have omega, omega, right? Omega to the omega, and so on. But it's still countable, okay? And then there are strange things like omega, 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 and so on. But it's always countable, okay? This is constructive here, okay? But we remain in the countable. So what I want to say, there's no constructive proof of this set, okay? Uncountable, well ordered. No constructive proof. Existence. Well ordered. So we can, so this is well ordered, this was schematically, okay? So every well ordered set starts in this way. It's unique, okay? You have always the next point, the next. Then here, you have the next point of all, okay, of all these and so on. So this is constructive here. We have infinitely many, but countable. Okay, we remain in the countable. So we call x equal s omega. Then you go on, no? And at a certain point, there's the explosion, and then it becomes uncountable for the first time. At this point, you call omega. This is a small omega, no? The small omega stands for countable. This is a capital omega. That's the first point where it's uncountable. Okay. So x, you call x in the theorem s omega. Okay. And you say that s omega bar. Well, there's a definition. S is s omega. Okay. We call it s omega. It's everything which is smaller than this, okay? That's this. Here, the section is uncountable for the first time. Here, it's always countable, okay? Before, it's countable. Here, it's the first time. Okay. So S omega union omega. And now I add one element. I add this omega, okay, to the set. And this is also well-ordered. This is also well-ordered. So we say this is the largest element. By definition, we just add formally. We call it omega. So this is also well ordered. This. So we have S omega, and we have this well ordered. And S omega bar is of course equal to what? So this is an interval, alpha 0, x, omega. Now we have omega. Okay? So we have everything between these two. Now omega is there. This s omega is alpha 0, omega, but it's not here, omega. Okay? We just artificially add it here. Okay? By the way, there's an exercise now, a small exercise. So this is a long exercise, S omega, the properties of S omega now, okay? This is a closed interval. Well, where to go on? I go on this side, okay. This is a closed interval. S omega bar is a closed interval. So S omega closed, this is S omega, union omega, so we add something which we call omega. That's a Y0 in the proof, okay? So this is a closed interval, alpha 0, omega, closed interval. The topology is the order topology. I didn't write it, but if you have an order, we have always the order topology. So it's a closed interval. And every well-ordered set has the least upper bound property, okay? Every ordered set. Every well-ordered set, sorry. Every well-ordered set has the least upper bound property. Why? What is the least upper bound? We take a bounded subset, okay? So this means the set of upper bounds is non-empty. But we are well-ordered, means it has the smallest element. So the least upper bound is the smallest upper bound which exists, if there is an upper bound, okay? So it has the least upper bound property. And then this is compact, okay? So this implies, that's a theorem which we proved. There's another application of this theorem. This means S omega bar is compact. Because it's a closed interval. So this is compact. S omega is not compact, okay? S omega is not compact. S omega bar, yes. But S omega is not compact. Why not? Well, not compact is easy, okay? We have an open covering without finite subcovering. So what is the open covering without a finite subcovering? Well, you take all sections, Sx, x in S omega. This is an open covering. That's a section of X, no? This is an open covering of S omega. Otherwise, if it's not an open covering, we have some element which is not in this section, okay? So we get a largest element. Otherwise, S omega would have a largest element, but then it would be countable. We have the section, okay? Otherwise, S omega would have the largest element. It would be countable. Then it would be countable because we have the section of the largest element. One element more doesn't matter. Otherwise, S omega would have the largest element and would be countable. But it is not countable. So this is an open covering of S omega without a finite subcovering, okay, without a finite subcovering. It has no finite subcovering. That's trivial almost. I mean, this is always easy. non-compact is easy. No, non-compact is easy. What is interesting is to prove it's compact, okay, but non-compact. If you had to find a subcovering, okay, then it would be equal to one of these sections. So you take the largest of finitely many. But this Sx does not contain x. So it's a contradiction, stupid contradiction, okay? It cannot be one of these. Because this Sx does not, it's the open, okay? Smaller than x. So it does not contain x, but x is in S omega, okay? Otherwise, S omega would be a large element without a finite subcovering. So it doesn't, by the same argument, okay? By a similar argument. So it's not compact. And now we prove that it's limit Poincaré. That's our example, first example, the only example. Well, S omega is limit Poincaré, okay? That's a Hausdorff space, which is compact, and it's very natural in some sense, because it's there. If you talk about well-ordered sets, then there's S omega, okay? If you assume the axiom of choice, there's S omega. Cannot avoid, okay? If you have the axiom of choice, then you have this, okay? And nobody wants to do mathematics without axiom of choice. Almost nobody. So we need a small lemma. So just a small lemma, and then we prove that it's limit point compact, S omega. It's limit point compact. The lemma says that every infinite subset, countable subset, okay? Not infinite, every countable subset of S omega has an upper bound in S omega, okay? Has an upper bound. Every countable subset, let's say A of S omega, sorry, has an upper bound in S omega. So this is completely different. So that means it's a countable subset. You cannot go too far, okay? You get stuck in this picture somewhere, okay? You cannot go to infinity, whatever infinity means. You cannot go to this omega, large omega, capital omega, okay? You cannot go to this capital omega. So every countable subset, A of S omega, has an upper bound. Proof. In the reals, you go to infinity, no? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, n, okay? You go to infinity, no upper bound. So it takes a section of A, A in A. This is a section of A, okay? Everything is smaller than A. For all A in A, it takes a unit. So this is countable. The sections are countable. So this is countable. Why? This is a countable union of countable sets, no? So countable. Countable union of countable sets. That's some diagonal counting, no? This kind of counting, okay? You have first counted, second, third, and then you count in this way, okay? Standard. So this is contained in S omega. So it's different because this is uncountable, okay? It's not equal to S omega. So any element in S omega, then any element in S omega minus this union so we take an element here which is not here is an upper bound of A by z. So take anything here which is not here. If it's not an upper bound of A, there's something larger. But then this element is in the section of the larger one. So it is here in some section, okay? So it's an upper bound. Otherwise, it would be in some, otherwise there would be something larger, and then this element is in the section of the larger element. So it would be here, but it's not here. So it's an upper bound. So that's it. And then also a least upper bound, okay? We have the least upper bound property, okay? But we are interested in upper bound. It's an upper bound of A. S omega has the least upper bound property. Well, ordered set has the least upper bound. So, proposition. S omega is not limit point compact. No. Not is not interesting. S omega is not compact. That we know, okay? It's limit point compact. Is limit point compact. S omega is limit point compact. Point, proof. So here we have to prove something, no? It is not compact, but it is limit point compact. And there we have to prove. So what? S omega is limit point compact. What means limit point compact? Limit point compact means that every infinite subset has a limit point, okay? And every infinite subset has a limit point. This is equivalent that every countable infinite subset has a limit point. Let A be an infinite countable. A countable subset of S omega. If we prove that this has a limit point, then every infinite subset has a limit point, okay? Because every subset has a countable. We can, for every subset, we can choose a countable subset, okay? Then we have a limit point for the countable subset, then we have a limit point for the larger subset. So it's sufficient that A be an infinite countable subset. That's sufficient to assume countable. So by the lemma, says countable is important here, no? It says that A has an upper bound. How did we call it? No name. As an upper bound, x0, I don't know how to call it. So that means A is contained in so this implies A is contained in well, alpha 0 is the smallest element. Of S omega, no. Like here, that is still, this is smallest. And then we have a largest, we have an upper bound now, x0, so we finish here. But this is a closed interval, okay? This is a closed interval. So this is the upper bound. Which I did, yes. So this is a closed interval. Again, S omega has the least upper bound property. Because the set of upper bounds has the smallest element, so that's the least upper bound. So S omega has the least upper bound property. So closed intervals are compact. That we proved, okay? This implies alpha 0, x 0 is compact. Closed intervals are compact. So it's compact. But A is an infinite subset, okay? So A is contained in alpha 0, x 0, infinite. Well, it's countable, but that, so A is a limit point. Compact implies limit point compact, okay? It's compact, and this implies limit point compact. It's compact. Then it's also limit point compact. That is in general, okay? So infinite subset, so A is a limit point. In alpha 0, x 0. But then also in S omega, no? The limit point is in S omega, of course. And hence also in S omega. So concluding, every infinite countable subset has a limit point, okay? Then every subset, infinite subset, has a limit point. That's clear. Because every infinite subset, you choose a countable subset. Maybe axiom of choice again, no. Whatever. I'm not an expert. And then you construct recursively a countable subset. And then you have a limit point of the countable subset. And then you have a limit point of the large subset. OK? So that's it. That's a proof. So corollary, so here's a picture of S omega. Stupid picture, OK? Smallest element, second, third, and so on. So the natural. So this is a copy of the natural numbers, OK, what you see here. This is the second copy of the natural numbers, what you see here. This is the third copy of the natural numbers. These are all well-ordered sets, OK? And every well-ordered set starts in this way. There are no others. Finite, yes, but that is not interesting. Infinite subset starts in this way, okay? And then you go and go and go and go, and it's countable, 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 and at a certain point, it jumps to uncountable, and then you call it omega. But that's not constructive. The rest is, in some sense, easy, but. Okay, so corollary. S omega is one of these examples, again, is first countable, but not metrizable, OK? So the third example, at least. RL, the ordered square, and now S omega. Another example, is first countable. It is first countable, but not metrizable. Why not metrizable? If it would be metrizable, metric, then compact and limit point compact are equivalent. But this is as long as first countable, but not metrizable. So first countable proof. We have to prove first countable, not first countable. Why is it first countable? So first countable means we take a point, let x be an S omega. And then we have to find this countable family of neighborhoods such that every neighborhood contains one of these. OK? Maybe decreasing, maybe not. There, it's not here, we cannot immediately have let x be an S omega. So what are the neighborhoods? So I take x prime. Alpha 0. No, y x prime, this kind of interval, So this is the immediate successor of X. X, okay? The immediate. So we say that each element has the next one. There's always the next one. Why? We take all which is are larger and then the minimum. That's the next one. So the immediate successor of X. So I call it X prime, okay? Here, X prime. X, then X prime is the next one. And Y, of course, smaller than X. So that means Y is in the section of X. Okay? So this is countable family of neighbors of X. Okay? It's a countable family of neighbors of X. It's a countable family, but because since SX is countable, the section is countable, okay? Since the section SX is countable. So it's countable. It's a countable family of neighborhood. Such that every neighborhood contains one of these, okay? We have the order topology, open intervals. So if you want X, then we have to go to the right of X, okay? A larger one. And the next one is X prime. And to the left, we take something smaller, okay? It's a countable family of neighbors of X, since the section SX is countable, such that every neighborhood of X contains one of these. Such that every neighborhood of X contains one of these. Since we have the order topology, okay? Since we have the order topology. We have the order topology. Open intervals, that's the basis, okay? Maybe there's one case where X is the first element, okay, which doesn't work here, but that's not an interesting case. It's discrete in many points, okay? In the small, if this would be the smallest element, where's this X? Then it's discrete here, okay? It's open. The point alpha zero is open, okay? The point alpha zero in S omega, the smallest element, is open. The next one is open. It looks discrete. The first point where it's not discrete is small omega, okay, in the picture. That's the first limit point. That's not discrete. But before it's discrete, looks like a discrete. It is a discrete space, okay? So what do you want to prove? S omega is first countable, but not metrizable. First countable. So this is first countable. By the way, it's ordered not in the standard way, okay? In general, we have U1 containing U2, containing U3, containing U4, okay? But that's ordered by the natural numbers. These are not, they are well ordered, but not by the natural numbers, no? Then maybe there's first copy of the natural numbers, second copy of natural numbers. So it's not immediately this U1 containing U2, no? To get that, we have to take intersections, okay? So here we count, but we count not by the natural numbers, this stuff, but by well-ordered set, okay? Not by N, not by the natural. By more, okay? So that's also important. So the last thing, S omega, exercise. S omega is not second countable. Point. It's not second. So that's always the same. Now we have RL. It's first countable, not second countable, okay? And it's not metrizable. The ordered square. It's first countable, but not second countable. not metrizable. No, F omega is first countable, not second countable, not metrizable, okay? So maybe second countable is a missing condition. They are not second countable, all this stuff, okay? That's a third example. So proof. It's the same proof, similar proof as for RL. Very similar now, okay? So let B, well, if I recall, if I remember the proof of RL, so second countable, we take any basis, okay? Let B, we take any basis, B, any basis of S omega. We take any basis of S omega. And then we take a point. For X in S omega, X is contained where? In alpha 0. That's the smallest element always, okay? And X prime. So that's the next one, X prime. Okay, it's contained in alpha 0 x prime. I have to concentrate. What do I want? Open. Yes, it's open. So this is open in S omega. That's not exactly open interval, but here on this side we have to do this, okay? So it's open by order topology. So it's open. But we have a basis. What does it mean? All is the same. So there exists. I go on here so I can see this here. So so this is open. This has a point. So there is Bx in B such that x is in Bx. Is contained in this open set, alpha 0, x prime. That's basis, okay? That's the topology generated by the basis. So we have a mapping from phi from S omega to B. For x, for each x, we have which, that's some axiom of choice, almost, okay? In some version, there's always axiom of choice. Now, I said we can avoid that for the construction of S omega, but then we cannot prove anything because we always using axiom of choice, axiom of choice. If you have the axiom of choice, we have also, that's not very difficult. If you have the axiom of choice, we have also the well-ordering theorem, okay? The proof is not difficult. One page. And Tron's lemma, okay? These are not difficult proofs. So Bx. So it's injective. This mapping is injective. If x is, suppose, so I write here, I go in this direction now, so I can continue this proof. Suppose x is smaller than y. Then we have x is in Bx, is contained in alpha 0 x prime, no? And y is in By. So for each point, we have this. It's contained in alpha 0 y prime, this immediate successor, OK? So what is x is smaller than y? X is smaller than y. X is smaller than y. So x smaller than y implies then, of course, that y is not where? X is smaller than y. So y is not here, OK? Y is not here. Y is not an element of alpha 0 x prime. It might be x prime, but it's open interval, OK? So y is not in Bx. But of course, y is in by, okay, by construction. So this implies what? That bx is different from by. What does that mean? That means phi is injective, okay? And what does that mean? That means B is uncountable. Since S omega is uncountable, okay? Since S omega is uncountable. So we have, and the proof is very similar to RL, okay? We have to define the sets a little bit different, but it's the same, more or less the same proof. So we have now these three examples, no? RL, the ordered square, and S omega. The problem with metrizability, they are first countable, no? So they might be metrizable, but they are not metrizable. Maybe they should be second countable. They are not second countable, okay? So if they are second countable, maybe we are better than first countable. Okay, so we have, this is a long exercise. Property versus omega, okay? First countable, not second countable, not compact, limit compact, not metrizable. So now starts the last chapter. Tomorrow is the last day, so I continue for 7 minutes. Because now the last chapter is normal spaces. So what is 1, 2, 3, 4? Normal spaces. So I give just a couple of definitions now. So what we know is T1. What is T1? I make a picture. T1. That means given 2 points, each has a neighborhood which does not contain the other. That's T1. Then we have T2. So this means given 2 points, each has a neighborhood which they have disjoint neighborhoods, okay? And then we have T3. So now we have a closed set. And a point not in this closed set. Okay, we have a closed set and a point not contained in the closed set. And then we have disjoint neighborhoods. So this is T3. Here we have disjoint neighborhoods. T3. This T1, T2, T3 is this picture. A closed set and the point not contained here have disjoint neighborhoods. And T4 is 2 closed sets. So these are closed. And then they have disjoint neighborhoods. So this is T4. Any 2 disjoint closed subsets have disjoint neighborhoods, okay? That's T4. Instead of points here, we have closed subsets. Unfortunately, T4 does not imply this, because then we have to know that points are closed to apply this, okay? But points are closed is T1. So there are spaces which are T4, but not T1. So points are not closed. So T4 does not imply T1 or T2 in general, okay? So then we define X is normal, X is regular, if it satisfies, if T1, T2, in general T2 or T1, that's, here makes no difference, T2 or T1, and T3, if T2 and T3 hold, are valid, that's called regular. So we need that points are closed, okay? And X is normal. That's the most interesting. X is normal if T2 or T1 and T4 hold, are valid. Okay, so this is regular normal. And then we have a hierarchy. Then We have a hierarchy. Normal implies regular, implies Hausdorff. Okay. T2. But in general, T4 does not imply T3, does not imply T2, okay? In general, that's not true. But so we have to add Hausdorff or T1. And now to convince you that this is a very useful thing, I prove how today, I have 3 minutes, every metric space is normal. So proposition. X metric, metrizable, implies X normal. A metrizable or metric space is normal. So this is another necessary condition for metrizable, okay? So normal, it's a necessary condition. We need normal. We have to, it's important. It's a necessary condition for metrizability, metrizable. Okay. So I will prove this. So we found this condition. So the proof is easy. So proof. I don't want to do that tomorrow because tomorrow I want to concentrate on Urizon. Okay. So this proof is easy. X metrizable implies X normal. So what means, X is T2, no? It's Hausdorff. That you know, okay? Metric space is Hausdorff. So we have to prove X is T4. So what means T4? Let A and B be disjoint closed subsets, okay? And we have to find disjoint neighbors. Where's the picture? This picture here. So let A and B be disjoint closed subsets. Of X. And we have to define disjoint neighborhoods, as in the picture, T4, okay? We have to find disjoint neighborhoods. For each A in A, so we have a ball, BD. We have a metric space, no? Metrizable. So we work with metric, okay? BD A, epsilon A, contained in X minus B, which is open, okay? X minus B. So this is open, of course. B is closed. It contains A, so there's a ball. So in a similar way, let for each B in A, let B the same. BD B epsilon B be contained where? In X minus A now. So this is open again, contains B, so there's a ball. That's a metric topology, okay? And now we want our disjoint neighborhood. So it seems we might take this U equal to union, where BD A, epsilon A, And V equal union, so A in A, sorry, A in A. And here B in B, union BD, B, epsilon B. These are neighborhoods, okay, of A and B. So this neighborhood of A of capital A, and this is the neighborhood of capital B. But they are not disjoint, it seems in general, but if we make a small modification, so we have to, we divide here, okay, by two, then they are disjoint. So, sorry, you have to divide by two, okay? Doesn't matter, it's still neighborhoods. Then, so, U intersection V is empty. If we have a point X in U intersection V, so this is an easy proof. I don't know if I should do that. Well, let's see. If it's not empty, if you have a point in the intersection, then X is in one of these and in one of these, okay? If X then. X is in one of these, BD, A, epsilon A, over 2. And X is also in one of these, BD, B, epsilon B over 2. Because it's in both. So now what is the distance between, now we ask for the distance between A and B. So this is smaller or equal, this is the usual triangular inequality. DAX plus DXB. This is smaller than what? Epsilon A over 2 plus epsilon B over 2. And then it's done. Suppose epsilon A is smaller than epsilon B, now supposing that, so suppose that epsilon A is smaller equal to epsilon B, then this is smaller than DRB is smaller than what? Epsilon A is smaller than epsilon B. So it's smaller than epsilon B, okay? Epsilon B. It's smaller than epsilon B. That means that A is in the ball around B with radius epsilon B. And that's a contradiction, no? Because they are disjoint, okay? A is in A. Contradiction. So this is okay. If we, so that's why we have to divide. Otherwise, the proof does not work, and it's not true. It seems also. So this is interesting, no? And the last theorem which I write, and maybe I'll prove also today, 1 minute, is compact Hausdorff spaces are normal, okay? So proposition. Also, compact spaces are normal. So normal seems to be useful property, no, because metric spaces are normal, compact. So proposition, that's the second one. X, compact Hausdorff space. Implies X normal. And here we need Hausdorff. Compact is not sufficient. Okay, we need to. So I indicate the proof in 1 minute, okay? We know the proof, more or less. We have seen such a proof. So proof, that's the last for today. So metric spaces are normal, compact Hausdorff spaces are normal, okay? This seems to be an interesting property, normal, okay? Because, so proof. X is a compact Hausdorff space. So in the first, the proof is interesting in the sense that we use G2. So X is G2. Hausdorff, T2 and compact. This implies X is T3. So we make it in two steps. So we go first to regular, okay, T3. T2 implies T3 if the space is compact. And then in the second step, T3 implies T4. That's, okay, T2, T3, and then T3, T4. So what means T3, I make a picture now, and this picture more or less we know. So we T3 means we have a closed subset, no? And we have a point not contained here, okay? And now the proof is this proof. For any point here, okay, we have disjoint neighborhoods. Okay. That's T2, we need T2. Then, here, on this, what do we see here? For each point, we have such a neighborhood and here, no? But A is closed, implies, closed implies always, closed in compact implies A is compact. Okay, A is closed, so it's compact. So here we see an open covering, right? All these. Finitely many suffice. And then what we take the union of these finitely many here, and we take the intersection of finitely many here. That proof we saw in another, where did we see that? We saw that when we proved that closed subset in a Hausdorff, this proof we saw more or less, okay? Because when we proved that closed, that compact subsets of a Hausdorff space are closed. That's this, more or less the same proof, okay? Compact subsets, so here is compact, okay? Compact subsets of a Hausdorff space are closed. We find here these intersections, and that's a neighborhood, okay, which doesn't contain, which is disjoint from A, okay? So it's the same proof. That's the first step. And now the last minute is the second step. So the second step is, where are we? Here. Second. So 2i, so x, t3, now we have t3, and compact implies x is t4. That's the second step, okay? And it's the same proof. Again, I make a picture now. So what means t4? If x is t3, and compact, then x is t4. So T4, we see, so we have two closed disjoint, okay? Closed disjoint subsets, all right? Now, we do the same, except we have not a point here, but we have a closed set, okay? So take any point A here. So this is AB. So these are disjoint closed. So we have A and B, disjoint closed. So take any point A, what is it called? No names here, okay? So this is A, sorry. A, and this is some point. So this is A. And now we have T3. What does it say? If we have a closed subset and the point, we find this raw neighbor. So now the picture is this. So here again we have this. And now we have this neighbor. Okay? And now we do the same. What we see here, we take all these. That's an open covering of A, which is compact again. So a finite subcovering. Then we take the union of these finitely many. That's okay. But then we take the intersection of the finitely many, okay, qui here. And then we get the neighborhood of B. So it's the same proof, like this, okay? You replace the point by B. So this is this might be B better, okay? And now this B becomes capital B. Okay? So this is a... So this shows that, where's the proposition? X compact Hausdorff space is normal, okay? So metric spaces and compact Hausdorff spaces are normal. So tomorrow is the last lecture, and then we go to maybe the most interesting theorem of the course, which is the Urizon metrization and Urizon lemma, okay? So we prove tomorrow the Urizon lemma first, and then the Urizon metrization theorem, okay? And the, as I said, it seems that second countable seems to be interesting, okay? In all these spaces, what is missing is second countable. So maybe if we have second countable, it's better, okay? Yes. So we go tomorrow, okay? We see tomorrow and go on with Urizon metrization. Okay. So are there remarks or questions? So then we see tomorrow, okay? I close the microphone now and tomorrow at 4. Okay, bye-bye.